Hello, and welcome to Software Architecture Monday. My name is Mark Richards. I'm an independent consultant, hands-on software architect, and also the founder of developer2architect.com. In today's lesson, we'll be taking a look at architecture trade-offs and architecture trade-off analysis. I want to start this lesson with a story, and it's a story of a ship called the Vasa. Now, in the 1620s, Poland and Sweden were at war, and the king of Sweden wanted a swift end to the war. So he called all of his advisors together and said, "I'm running out of time, I'm running out of money, and I'm running out of patience. How do I end this war swiftly?" And all of the king of Sweden's advisors said, "Naval superiority will win this war." So the king said, "Great, let's do it." So he commissioned the best ship's architect of that time and said, "I would like you to build me this ship." Now, this was a ship like no other ship had ever been seen before. It was supposed to be over 200 feet long, have 64 guns on two gun decks, and be able to carry 300 troops safely across battle-driven waters into Poland. "Build this ship, and we will win this war, quickly and swiftly." Well, the ship's architect had never built a ship like this before. No one ever has. 30 guns was pretty much a maximum. 200 feet was very, very long for these kind of ships. And as a matter of fact, two gun decks was never even heard of before. And even combining a transport with a battleship was never done before. But the architect extrapolated on his experience. He got together the best ship rights, which would be developers, in all of Sweden, and built this ship. Well, the ship was, in fact, built to specification, sailed out into the harbor, fired its gun salute, and promptly sank to the bottom of the ocean. It's a sad story about the ship called the Vasa. Well, what happened? Well, technically, the ship was too bottom heavy, and when the guns fired on one side, it tipped the ship over, and the ports filled up with water, and it sank. But that's not really the real reason why it sank. The reason it sank was because the ship's architect tried to do too much. All of those kind of things he was trying to do with the guns, with the size, with transporting troops, he wasn't able to do it all. And as a matter of fact, that's the same thing that happens to us as architects. The story of the Vasa is an extremely important story in terms of understanding architecture characteristics, in other words, those illities and the trade-offs associated with those. For example, in our world, you might have, for the exact same system, these statements, you know, "We need lightning fast response time to keep up with a backlog of calls," which we know of as performance. "Over time, we are expecting the entire company to use this system," which we can translate to, of course, scalability. "Oh, by the way, we're planning to acquire several businesses in the next 5 years. Well, that's going to force me to think about extensibility, agility, that ability to respond quickly to change and overall maintainability in my applications." And of course, there's always that stakeholder who says, "Oh, by the way, the budget and time frame for the system is very, very tight," which we know of as feasibility. And the problem is, as architects, if we try to satisfy every single one of these illities and max those out, we will be just like the ship's architect in the Vasa, and hopefully not end up at the bottom of the ocean, but we will end up in trouble. So there's a couple of processes that can actually help us in determining the trade-offs about illities. And when I say about trade-offs, it's this. When we start looking at performance and availability, the more available I make a system, the less performant it will be. And so it's almost like a scale, if you can think about it, like those scales of justice with the two buckets on either end. And the more we apply changes to support availability, the less performance we have. And so we have to trade these things off. Well, ATAM, Architecture Trade-Off Analysis Method, is one of those processes. This process has a proposed architecture that we submit there. It has the business drivers, in other words, what are some of the concerns and scenarios in the business, and also all of the quality attributes, in other words, those illities or architecture characteristics that we defined. We go through this process with the stakeholders of kind of almost like defending a thesis, almost in a way, for a PhD. So the business stakeholders all produce scenarios, and we kind of validate those scenarios through the architecture. And what comes out of this whole process is a validated and approved architecture. Now, at the end of this lesson, I'll show you some resources to get more information, but I really want to kind of show you these processes at a high level so you can dive in and be aware of them. Now, ATAM is a good process, but it has some issues associated with it. For example, it assumes that the architecture is complete, that you've already done an architecture, and that's usually a problem because we've spent so much time creating an architecture that may not work. And so that's problem one. Problem two are that stakeholders are often busy and also distributed, which means that it's hard to get all the stakeholders into a room. As a matter of fact, I maintain you would never want to get all stakeholders into the same room. That would be interesting, let's put it that way. You know, the other thing the original ATAM process assumes, and this is a one-time process. Well, we know with evolutionary architecture and emergent design that we may start with an architecture, but that architecture evolves with every new requirement. And the last thing is it's assumed that all the scenarios from all the businesses or users are known up front. These are the problems associated with ATAM. Now, it's not really ATAM itself that's a problem. It's just the overall process of ATAM. So here's what I would recommend from a kind of an agile ATAM process is to repeatedly do these steps. And the first step is really initially to create an architecture presentation. Now you need an architecture presentation for ATAM, but focusing on the goals and not the process is the real key to getting ATAM to work. So the first step is creating an architecture presentation, a very clear and concise, and I should say architecture presentations, because usually you'll have multiple presentations and multiple views and multiple scopes, one for stakeholders, one for other architects, one for developers, one for operations, so on and so forth. But creating this presentation is a really great exercise in learning how to describe your architecture. The second goal and thing to focus on as ATAM is not necessarily the process, but make sure we can validate the architecture, establish trade-offs, and get buy-in from stakeholders. And that last part is perhaps the most significant. It's also to identify and mitigate risk. And risk storming is a great way of not only having fun, but also being able to identify and mitigate the risk involved. This happens during the ATAM process itself. And as I mentioned in the second point here, to get stakeholder buy-in, in other words, everybody agrees that this architecture will solve all the issues, both functional as well as business problems. There is another process that I want to tell you about, and that's called CBAM, cost-benefit analysis method. Now, of late, these do separately exist, but of late, and I'd say probably in about the past 5 years or so, I've seen some great work in actually combining ATAM and CBAM together. But CBAM doesn't really trade off what's more important, availability or performance, and where that line is going to be drawn in the scale, but really cost. So in other words, business goals as part of our architecture produce all those illities. In other words, performance, availability. These are deemed as benefits of the architecture. Now what CBAM does is it then assesses the cost of all those benefits and basically tries to maximize the difference of each of these. And so instead of weighing availability versus performance, it's how much is that availability going to cost me? And maybe five nines of availability, 99.999%, maybe goes down to four nines of availability in order to reduce the cost. You can get more information about each of these from the book Software Architecture in Practice, 3rd edition, by Bass and Clements. SEI, the Software Engineering Institute, has a couple of good resources about ATAM, which is the first link that you see there, and CBAM, which is the second. What I would encourage, again, kind of in summary, is to focus on, first of all, combining both of these in one unit. In other words, assessing the trade-off analysis of our illities or architecture characteristics in conjunction with cost, and then focusing on the goals, not necessarily the overall process, and basically make it work how it works for you, not necessarily the stringent process of ATAM. So this has been Software Architecture Monday, Lesson 17, Architecture Trade-Offs. Stay tuned next Monday where I'll have another lesson for you. Thank you very much.